started. Why don't we go ahead and get started? So I will call, here's the agenda. Call this meeting to order, the March 7th Community Planning and Development Commission. Good evening, everybody. So first up on the agenda, we've got a signed permit application for Supercuts at 44, aka 48 Walkersbrook Drive. And who's here representing? Good evening. Thank you. Let me ask Julie, is any opening comments you want to provide?
I think it's a pretty straightforward application. It's for a 16 square foot wall sign that's going to be comprised entirely of letters that say Supercuts. I believe they're red. There's no master signage plan for this site.
Okay, that was my next question.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So you look at all the signs individually on their own. But it does comply with the requirements of the PUDI zoning district.
So, want to write any background, or?
Sure, and it is, it's very simple. Basically, we did exactly what Wilder asked us to do in the plaza. So, it's actually below what code would allow red channel letters on the wall, and that's it.
And are you from Supercuts, or from the sign?
I'm from Viewpoint Sign and Awning.
Okay.
Yeah, but I do all the, this is a large franchisee of Supercuts.
Sure, sure. So. Okay.
So it's his standard logo, which is what that
means. So standard logo, the size is appropriate, it's gonna be internally illuminated.
Correct, with LED.
Okay. And is anything going on the front, like the big pillar at the entrance to?
No, that's major tenants.
Oh, okay.
Only.
So that's not.
The small stores don't get it.
Okay, great, thank you.
Yeah.
Do you guys have any questions?
Nope.
All right.
This is the space that used to be Verizon Warehouse?
It's next to Verizon, but
okay.
I think they've recently built this out because there's a restaurant,
yes.
A new restaurant there.
This is the former Macaroni Grill. It was broken up into Supercuts, Chipotle, and Anthony's Coal Fired Pizza. The Verizon is still there.
This is the number
three,
okay.
The first one,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right there.
Yep.
Take care.
So there's no Supercut sign on any of the freestanding signs by the perimeter of the lot?
They may be able to get one.
Okay. I thought they had gotten approval for a space when they came to you a month ago.
Expanding that.
Maybe, I don't remember.
There were touring cars.
Yeah, and I thought one of them was going to be for Supercuts.
Okay. Yeah, according to Wilder, they were handling that. So
yeah,
there was
okay.
No permitting needed.
Okay. Okay. Good. Do we have a, we'll take a look at the certificate of appropriateness. Right.
Move that the CPDC approve the certificate of appropriateness for the Supercut sign at 44 or 20 or 48 Walkersbrook Drive, whichever number is appropriate.
Second.
All those in favor? And abstain? Okay, so good, that, you're good to go on this. Is it 20 or 48?
It's technically Supercuts is 44. But when you look at the whole site on our GIS system, it comes up as 20. And then these tenants are they're all using the number 48 because that space, I guess, used to be 48. Even though now it's 44, 46, and 48.
Okay.
So the application's a little erroneous, but I corrected it on the certificate.
Okay, cool, cool.
Yeah.
So do I need to stamp this?
Oh.
Right?
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you. All right. Well, thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Good to go. Yeah, no problem.
Second one.
Yes, yeah, second up on the agenda, another signed permit application for Reading Square Barbershop, 11 Pleasant Street. And who is here representing that application? Hi, good evening. How are you?
Good.
Good. Julie, anything you want to open up with?
So this application is for two signs. One is a blade sign, and the other one is a wall sign sort of above the doorway in like an area that's kind of carved into the building. Not maybe as straightforward as the other one. This is in the Business B zoning district.
Okay.
That's, as far as I can tell, it complies with the Business B regulations.
Can I just take this from you?
No.
Okay. All right. Any comments you want to make about your application or intro?
Yeah, I don't believe so. Anna Seiko, she's the one that does our lettering. She's under the weather. That's why she would normally be here. But we went with the Reading colors. We're actually both born and raised in the town. The samples, which I believe you guys all have, Julie said one of them's like a little bit of an indentation of the building. It sits right above the door when you walk in. The other one is just a blade sign. Yes.
It's pretty
straightforward. Yeah. I don't know if there's anything. It was a stylist before. She kind of had a similar sign on the front. She didn't use the blade sign, but she used the door sign prior to that.
Okay. You gonna have any lighting on these?
There is an overhead light in the indentation, but that's strictly for the
okay.
Walkway.
Oh, okay. But nothing on the blade sign?
No, not.
Okay. Thank you. What questions do we have?
Yeah, there are two different heights shown on the pictures.
Right.
So this picture from the side shows it just above this cornice right here. And then the picture from the front shows it way up high by the windows, or the other side. The side picture shows it down here.
Yeah, the, I don't know if the, but it was photoshopped in there. It's, the bottom of the sign is 14 feet from the sidewalk.
That's where you want it?
Yes, that was what we had drawn up.
It's an existing
bracket that was there prior.
We were just gonna
hang from that. That I believe the bracket is 16 feet from the sidewalk and the side.
Yeah.
I believe it's 2 feet.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Okay. Because I was gonna ask you why you don't put it over more, or the doorway more. It's already there.
Yeah. The bracket is already there.
If we can, maybe.
Does Latham actually have an entrance in that?
No, Latham's entrance is towards the front, and there, where the picture is, you can kind of see there's a doorway on the side.
Yeah.
That goes upstairs to the office above.
Okay.
Do you want to move it? I mean, or you
no,
can.
Actually,
that's...
I'd rather, it's not so far, it's still under our business per se. There's still where the windows are.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like towards, a little bit towards the square.
Mm-hmm.
If I could keep it there, I wouldn't mind. That way I wouldn't have to disrupt anything in the building.
Right, right.
Okay.
I mean, if you find that it's confusing, you might want to come back and tell me again. But if people keep paying the wrong building,
yep.
So we're going to check the brackets and make sure it's most of your time.
Okay.
Okay. So it's probably not that.
Any other questions?
Move that the CPDC approve the certificate of appropriateness for the Reading Square Barbershop sign at 11 Pleasant Street.
Second.
All those in favor? All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you.
All right, so I'm not going to... I'll just stamp this one and these two.
Right.
Right?
Right.
And chuck this one.
Yeah.
Actually,
right,
that it's an existing bracket.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, the existing bracket is in the COA.
It does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was just thinking of the picture.
Mm.
All right. Next up on our agenda. Oh, wow. We're cruising here. Sign bylaw discussion, presentation by town council. Good evening.
Hi, how are you?
I'm well. How you doing?
Good.
Good. Jean or Jess, or I'm sorry, Jeff. Julie, anything you want to open up with on this?
What is there to say about
signs? Everything.
It's a vast and wondrous topic, and I'm so very happy to have town council leading us tonight.
Do you have a PowerPoint or do you need the computer? Okay, I have the document that you gave us like up on the screen if you want to reference it.
Okay, well we'll see where the conversation takes us.
Okay.
Okay, so those of you who don't know, my associate Greg Lansing, who is on 24/7 duty, me doing sign bylaws throughout the Commonwealth for our various clients. So Hopkinton is in the unusual position that it was actually contemplating redoing its sign by law even before the Supreme Court got involved in this. But about a year ago, I started advising clients to be very cautious about enforcing their zoning bylaws because there was a case pending before the U.S. Supreme Court that might, in fact, alter all the rules. And, in fact, that's exactly what did happen. The case involved a sign ordinance in the town of Gilbert, Arizona. The sign in question that was got the plaintiff in trouble was a sign that directed people to where Sunday services were going to be held. Apparently, this church met in different places at different times, so it was a temporary sign, and the sign went on to say, "Everybody welcome." And because it said, "Everybody welcome," the town of Gilbert said it's not a directional sign, and we only allow directional signs in this particular location. They ordered the sign to be taken down, and the plaintiffs appealed, and they went all the way to the Supreme Court. So the defense that was offered in that case was that we are not infringing on free speech because we are not regulating the content of the sign, we are regulating the function of the sign, and that directional signs are one category and can be regulated in one way, and other kinds of signs have a different function and can be regulated that way, differently. The Supreme Court would have none of it, indicating that when you regulate by function, you are in fact regulating by content, because you don't know the function of the sign unless you look at the content, and so therefore the Supreme Court invalidated the zoning ordinance and took along with it essentially every zoning ordinance and bylaw across the country that regulate signs, because all of them regulate by function, as does yours. Yours also has a few regulations that actually are just direct regulation of content, which we already knew was a problem before we started, but we have a number of concerns that are based on the Reed case. Now, the Reed decision was written by Clarence Thomas, and whatever you think about his jurisprudence otherwise, this particular decision raises more questions than it actually answers. And that's because Justice Thomas didn't apparently think it was necessary to refer to any of the previous Supreme Court cases involving signs. And there have been quite a few over the years. Didn't tell us whether those other cases are still good law or not. So, for example, there had been a previous Supreme Court case that said it was okay to regulate off-premises signs differently from on-premises signs. So basically, if you off-premises signs, the most commonly regulated ones are billboards that, you know, don't pertain to the premises that they are on. Those were previously upheld as a proper exercise of local regulatory power, but Thomas, if you applied his rule, which is if you have to read the sign in order to know what category it falls in, then you are regulating by content. It seems like Justice Thomas would be invalidating even any kind of regulation directed at billboards. Justice Alito wrote a concurring opinion. I think he was basically attempting to rehabilitate Justice Thomas, and he provided us with a list that said, these are all the kinds of regulations that are still okay. And in my letter on the second page, the list is reproduced in its entirety exactly as Justice Alito gave it to us. You will note that Justice Alito says that we still can regulate signs that are on the premises versus differently from signs that are off the premises. So he doesn't read the plurality opinion quite as strictly as you'd think he would, but in any case, we've decided to advise our clients that we're going with Justice Alito's list. So these are the rules that we're going by as we evaluate local bylaws. There's plenty that needs to be changed. even if we just stick with Justice Alito's slightly more liberal version of what's permitted and what's not permitted. And if at some time in the future the Supreme Court decides to explain itself better, we will deal with it at that time. But we think that that the best rule here is to follow the list that Justice Alito gave us, since it's a sort of concrete guidance. So what we did for your consideration is to go through your existing zoning bylaw and to identify the provisions that we think need attention. And that is, there, we did it, okay. On that list. If you want, we can go through them one by one, but I think your time is probably better utilized by thinking first whether this is even the approach you want to do. That is, do you want to go through your existing bylaw, make various changes to it, and try to bring it up to snuff piece by piece, or whether your preference really is to start over from scratch. And if your preference is to start over from scratch, we gave you an example of scratch, which is a model bylaw that has been developed by an organization with the odd title, the International Municipal Law Association, which we think is an odd title because if there's ever an area where it is most assuredly not international, it would be municipal law. But in any case, despite its name, it's the National Organization of Municipal Lawyers, and we look to them for guidance on topics that are not unique to Massachusetts, but exist overall. And so they gave us a model to work from, and it's a perfectly good model, but of course it's not particularized at all to Reading. And so towns that have that we have given the option to, I think only one has actually decided to work from the MO model. Everybody else has decided to try to doctor up their existing bylaw. Either way, it's perfectly fine from our point of view. Your existing bylaw, I will say, of all the towns that we represent, it is by far the most complex and certainly the longest. And that was true a year ago or a year and a half ago when I first tried to take it on, and it still remains true. So I guess the first order of business is to think about which approach you'd like to follow. That is, take the existing bylaw and doctor it up, or take something that is a model and add the local content to it.
Any initial thoughts on that?
Well, I think either way, we have to look at the intent of our bylaw, which slowly try to address the issues that are important to us and make sure that we're getting to whatever new bylaw. So if we start from scratch without referencing this one, I'm afraid we'll miss something that's important. I think we take this table that you've come up with and look at our bylaw and see what the intent of any piece of it is, and then see if it still holds, then make sure that transfers over. I just don't want to miss something that we thought was important. So I'm completely from scratch. So do we have to rewrite
this bylaw plus the signage sections of 40R of the downtown Smart Grove.
And the signage in the PUD district as well.
But those will be edited within those sections, is that correct? Or do we have to take all of the signage out of all the individual sections and then put them into this one master?
Well, here's a question. So, ideally, it seems to me, you want all of your sign provisions in one place. You can certainly regulate by zoning districts. So if you want the rules to be different in those specialized districts, they certainly can be. As long as you have a rational basis for doing so.
Rational, okay. As opposed to what SCOTUS did.
I'm sorry?
Rational as opposed to what the Supreme Court just did.
To be clear, what the Supreme Court said was you are infringing on the First Amendment, and when you do that, you have to have more than just a rational basis. It has to sustain what's called strict scrutiny, and basically what that means is that the regulation must promote important local value, and it has to be narrowly constructed so that that value can't be pursued in any other way. It's a test that is devised that virtually everything fails. So there's always a way of doing things more pinpointedly or without infringing on the First Amendment. So, for example, one of the things that is on that table, we currently regulate for sale signs that advertise that a property is for sale, and the what we are advising you to do is instead of focusing on the content of the sign and saying that's a sign for sale, regulate properties that are for sale, signs that appear on properties that are for sale. So you can have an extra sign on a property that is for sale that you otherwise wouldn't be allowed to have. And you see how we managed to do that without saying what's on that sign and therefore staying away from infringing on the First Amendment. So those are the kinds of regulatory tricks that we have to employ here.
Does that include cars, property? So does if you have a house that's for sale and a car that's for sale, and a van that's for sale and a motorcycle that's for sale, can you have a sign on each of those properties?
If you want to have a regulation governing signs that appear on cars that are for sale, you can do that.
How does Alito's list differ from the previous decisions you said aren't referenced in Thomas's?
Well, I would say that
Or is his list in lieu of the references?
No, they attempt to actually reincorporate the rulings that have been made in the past.
Okay, because didn't the Supreme Court just chastise some lower federal court for not enforcing, this is Louisiana, I think it was an anti-abortion law, not enforcing some law because their latest decision didn't reference the previous decisions, and they kind of told them to knock it off and do what they've done before. So by not referencing previous decisions, I want to know how far our reach really is. Is it just Alito's list, or is it what happened before, too?
I think if we stick to Alito's list, we're safe. If we go beyond Alito's list, I think that we're not safe.
Okay.
I think Alito attempted to recodify the prior case law in his list.
Okay.
I don't know much about abortion decisions, so
Well, just a general statement that they seem to have been angry with this lower court that didn't want to enforce a new ruling because they hadn't mentioned the previous rulings.
Well, God knows what goes on in Louisiana.
Well, it's a matter of superseding the previous one or additive.
Yeah, that's
well, and in this case, Justice Thomas didn't really acknowledge, other than to announce a rule that seems to be superimposed on a lot of other things, which is that you can no longer regulate signs by function unless you have an overriding state interest in doing so, and you've crafted your bylaw as narrowly as possible so as to minimize any First Amendment impacts. But essentially that means you can't do it at all. Taken to its logical extreme, decisions like the one that upheld billboard regulation, you can't tell whether that sign pertains to a business on the property or not unless you regulate it by its content. So Alito says it's still all right, and I'm going with it.
Okay. This is a mess, in my humble opinion. I'm wondering,
I agree with that.
I'm wondering if we more or less eliminated the sign regulations per se and replaced them with usage regulation. For example, a billboard is a use of a piece of property for advertising purposes. And it's something that, this is off the wall. But the other thing that, some of the things which have been, have come up in the past about signage is the location and duration. Mm-hmm. Now, if we define a sign as a temporary structure, then can we regulate the location and duration of temporary structures,
mm-hmm.
whatever their function?
You can, although you probably don't want to define a sign as a, because not all signs are temporary. Many signs are pretty.
But I'm thinking that particularly in residential zones. You've got front yard setbacks, you've got side yard setbacks, and so forth, which can be used to mitigate some of
and
the.
And you can also, in a residential zone, you can limit the number of signs on a lot.
No, you mean the temporary structures?
Well, if you're going to lump them in with other kinds of temporary structures, you may end up with some oddball results.
It's a thought rather than a proposal.
Okay.
It may be a bad thought. Who knows?
Trying to think of how we want to move this forward.
Well, I think we have to look at the example code that you've given us and the list and figure out what's still valid, what might be crafted to be enforceable, and indicate which ones of those want to move into this new code and how we would reword those.
Is it strictly content that we're talking about here? Can we still regulate size and number?
Yes.
Location.
Location, all of those things.
It's just The content.
So let me ask you a question then. So now, does that then allow us to regulate signs put up by nonprofits now, churches? Do they have to comply with these new rules?
Well, no. And no, because, but that has nothing to do with constitutional law. That has to do with the Dover Amendment. If a sign is part of a Dover Amendment use, so it's a church or it's an educational, right now you have a provision that is broader than that because you exempt all nonprofits. That is not compelled by the Dover Amendment. It's not compelled by constitutional law.
Dover Amendment is strictly for permanent signs or for temporary signs as well?
This applies to both temporary and permanent. So so the exemption that you have now is very broad, much broader than we've seen in other towns. I mean, it's not compelled by the Dover Amendment. It's not compelled by any constitutional principle that I know of. So if your question is, can we regulate signs that on nonprofits that don't qualify as Dover members, certainly yes, if you choose to. Okay, so if you go down this list, you see in the definitions you've got 5 definitions that are the kinds of things that are going to get you in trouble under Reed. These are definitions that require reference to the content of the sign in order to know whether they qualify for these definitions, and then these definitions are then used later on to regulate or to exempt from regulation. The one that if you look at the third one, information and directional signs, that's exactly the kind of a sign was at issue in the Gilbert decision, whether something was a directional sign or something else. All of these require you to look at the content of the sign to determine whether they fit the category. So we have suggested, in some cases we were able to figure out something different. So if something has a commercial message, that's going to be, defining it in terms of its commercial message is a problem, but saying that it's on a property that's used for commercial use, and it's not a problem. So that's not the same. It doesn't draw the line exactly the same way, but it's something that would be fairly close and then permissible. So a commercial sign would be defined as a sign located on a property that is devoted to a commercial use.
I find it hard to believe that the intent of this decision was to say that you cannot regulate no parking sign. You can't say no parking.
Well, you can. So, what you can't do is to say it's not that you. To say signs that say no parking get preferential treatment.
I can't say that.
You cannot do that.
So then I would have to make it a category, directional
yes.
sign. And you're saying I can't say
you
that?
You can't call, well, because directional, unless you can come up with a way of defining directional sign that without regard to the content.
It says no parking. It doesn't say nobody parking, as opposed to all are welcome from your previous sign. By the way, wasn't the sign in question actually a temporary sign?
It
weren't
was.
They moving them around?
It was.
And so a permanent sign that offered direction, say the lion signs or the club signs that are on the telephone pole sometimes when you enter the town, right? Rotary Club, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
Those are permanently affixed signs that give direction.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds different.
Give direction. So permanent,
yeah, it'll say meets at the Elks or something.
Okay.
Like that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Makes, you know,
so,
information.
So when you say, so first of all, those signs are located in the right of way, right? They're affixed to.
No, I'm going to ignore them all, but.
They're probably located in the right of way. So there's a special category here for things that are located in the right of way, because those generally require the permission of the road commissioners, which I presumably is the Board of Selectmen, right?
Selectmen.
Yes. Okay. So because they have control of the right of way. Right. So usually your zoning, I would interpret your zoning bylaw to exempt signs that are in the right of way.
In some cases, they're in areas that are controlled by Mass Highway.
Well, it's Mass Highway's right of way.
The same.
But they would need the permission of Mass Highway to get to do that.
How does this relate to the manual and uniform traffic control devices? Like,
how does it relate to it?
Yeah, I mean, because those are necessary for public safety.
So, most zoning bylaws exempt government signs.
Yeah. The P, the blue P and
yeah.
all that, it's all exempt.
Right. Would be exempt.
These traffic signs, these information and directional signs, if we classify them as safety signs, so certainly, well, you've got fire
mm-hmm.
lanes.
I'm sorry?
You have fire lanes. You have no parking in certain areas for fire lanes and egress issues.
Mm-hmm.
It's exempt too.
Mm-hmm.
Those are exempt.
Well, it depends on where they are. You're saying in fire lane of a private property?
Sure. A bank comes in and wants to redo their signs, right?
Uh-huh.
There are some areas where there should be no parking versus, say, customer parking or employee parking. Those
mm-hmm.
I'm trying to differentiate between those signs. I really need to understand why that's an issue, because I don't understand it. I don't understand why we couldn't put a no parking sign up or tell them.
No one is suggesting that you can't put a no parking sign. What we're just saying is, what the Supreme Court is telling you, it's not me. The Supreme Court is telling you is that you can't give special treatment to that sign. So you can say.
You can't separately identify it with a different regulation.
Right. So you can't say you're only allowed two signs, but you're allowed more signs if there are no parking signs.
Because then you have to read it to determine.
Right. But if you said then say on a commercial property that the number of signs, the total number of signs, is limited to a certain number or unlimited or a certain area, or all the signs have to be a certain distance from the side yards or whatever you want to do, you can do that. What you can't do is to say, if there are no parking signs, they get special treatment.
So I have a sign that says Nick's Business, and it's 6 feet by 2 feet. My parking sign can be 6 feet by 2 feet, my no parking sign. Because I can't differentiate it from any of the other signs on this property.
You can. You can say you're entitled to one sign that's 6 feet by 2 feet, and all the other signs have to be smaller.
Is there another way to categorize this type of signage that doesn't like lead to content? I mean, because that's, I think, what he's getting at. Like, we can't put these in a category. How can we discern them from other types of signage on the property.
Well, that is the point.
I mean, I'm just not infringing on his speech if I ask him to put in, you know, to have traffic and safety signs on his site. To have regulations for traffic and safety signs. I am in no way harming their ability to, their freedom of speech, which is allegedly the intent.
But what you are doing is you're giving preference to a certain kind of speech over other kinds of speech.
Tony, you had a question?
Tony DiRosso, 130 John Street. On the second page of the memorandum from town council, very tough line, it says, they may survive strict scrutiny only if the municipality proves that they are narrowly tailored to serve a compelling governmental interest. I would assume traffic signs, no parking, and so forth, wouldn't survive such a test. I think we're getting down into the minutiae here, going into absurdity. I think you would be safe with traffic signs, because it is a compelling government interest to ensure that traffic laws are followed and that fire lanes are kept clean, clear, and so forth.
So, keep in mind that government signs are going to be exempt. So, we're only talking about signs that are located on, not in the right-of-way. You're talking about acquiring a fire lane, for example, as part of your site plan review. You acquire a site, a fire lane, and you say it needs to be adequately marked, you're fine. If you want to require that the property owner prohibit parking in a certain part of his property, you're fine. What you can't do is to say you need to put three signs that say no parking there. Okay, it's good. It's just going to require you to rejigger your thinking on how you do a site plan review, for example.
Government signs are exempt, so the town of Reading's signs are exempt.
That's correct.
So can we require the town of Reading signs on private property?
Well, there will be.
Part of site plan review. Town of Reading requires no parking signs at all, no parking spaces.
A sign that is identical to a government sign, but is not in fact owned and placed by the government, isn't really a government sign anymore. So, I mean, you often see, for example, stop signs that are located on private property.
I don't mean to be a pain. I'm really just trying to figure out that when we write this thing, I really don't think the smaller businesses are going to take you to court for every little sign. They'll just do what they want and hope that we don't enforce it. It's the potential for some larger developer to come in and start annoying us by dragging our attorneys into court.
Well, most sign bylaws get you into trouble not that way, but the other way, when the building inspector, you know, finds a sign, orders it taken down. That's usually where these controversies arise is when town attempts to enforce a prohibition. So that's what happened in Gilbert in the Reed case. This would have, you know, if the town had just let the sign go, none of this ever would have happened. In the time that I've been town council, I only know one time when I had to advise against enforcement of a zoning prohibition, and that is the limits that you have on political signs. But hopefully your zoning enforcement officer isn't, I know that he is not going around looking for trouble. But I don't think it's fair to say, well, small businesses will just go ahead and do what they want.
They're doing that? I think our bylaw is actually fairly reasonable. I think the South Main Street signs are too big. You know, that 50 square feet of signage is far too big for the size properties we have. But you can drive around and you'll find violations to what we do have for, and it's never enforced. We tried to clean it up a few years back and pretty much told nothing's going to happen. So you know, you're going to give them this much and they're going to put up that much. They're going to park their vehicles with signs on them. They're going to have signs in the window. They'll have temporary banners. All that stuff happens all the time. So we can't regulate it even now. What I don't want to see is it for the get just blossom out of control entirely. Really just trying to have something discreet. Certainly have a business have enough ability to show itself off. But this commercial use you're talking about, this example you gave, so if we said a commercial property can have 1 6-foot by 2-foot sign, 3 3-foot by 3-foot signs, and all of the signs must be 1 foot by 2 foot, something like that. Mm-hmm. That would pass.
Sure.
We would say no parking spaces must be adequately marked. Fire lanes must be adequately marked. Mm-hmm. Can we say with a sign no larger than?
Yeah, as long as you're regulating the medium and not the message, that's fine.
Okay.
So Nick's leading up the subcommittee to. No, he is. This is true.
Your cell phone number.
We're trying to break up our zoning priority work efforts for November town meeting into separate committees, and Nick's. Excuse me?
Nick is a committee of one?
No, I'm hoping to get some support.
Yeah, no, we're going to be staffing it up a bit.
Okay.
But I guess bleeding a little bit into our next topic of timeline and all that, I mean, there's a lot of work here and still a lot of questions.
Can I just ask a quick before you move on?
Sure.
Can I ask a quick question, Mary Ellen O'Neill? Do you have a sense of what do we have the most to lose by making this revision? Are there some certain things in there that you sense are important to writing that we could lose in this revision? Or are we going to be able to keep most of what we want?
I think that it's possible to rewrite this and keep 95% of what we want. Assuming that what you want is defined a little bit broadly. So for example, you have a provision right now that allows the display of a flag that says open. Obviously that's content-based and it's got to go. So as long as
that'll be problems.
Okay. So assuming that we define what you want as in sort of generic terms instead of word, what percentage of the words are you going to be able to keep? I think you can probably do it. Keep in mind that the stakes for losing a battle over an infringement over the First Amendment. So what happens is you get, as they didn't read, they bring this as a civil rights claim. It is a civil rights claim. And at the end of the day, having been victorious, they get all of their attorney's fees awarded to be paid by the municipality. So you don't really want to ever be on the losing end of one of these. Not that it's, that common, but it does happen from time to time. And you really don't want to, you won't be awarded damages, but attorney's fees can be pretty significant.
Well, this is a big scam by the attorneys, isn't it? To drum up business.
Oh my God.
Sure.
The First Amendment is a big scam. Say that?
No.
No,
but I mean,
so.
I want parking now. You're not infringing my free speech.
Okay.
It just seems like the decision could have been written more narrowly. How's that?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, but the guy's a Supreme Court justice. I mean, I don't know what else to say. You know, they got to let him write something.
I guess.
So unfortunately, they let him write this.
Then the other guy had to come in and like rewrite it for him, basically.
Right. Exactly.
It's just that it's causing a lot of problems, as you can see.
Believe me, I know. That's what you got.
Do you have any clients that have passed a revised sign bylaw?
Yeah, no. We've got bylaws in Hopkinton and in Stockbridge that are going to go before the spring town meeting.
And so then that has to get past the AG, right?
Yep.
And they're going to base it on their interpretation of this? And do
yep.
we understand how they've interpreted this?
Mm.
I guess now we've got another.
Are you suggesting that they would interpret differently from the way I have?
It's another lawyer. Yeah, we get decisions. We get lawyers on both sides of this aisle here all the time that disagree on Dover.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah. So I don't know whether we've seen any approvals yet.
Not to my.
I don't think we've seen any approvals
okay, so
or disapprovals from.
No guidance. No guidance yet.
I normally don't. From what I can see. What we get back from the AG's office, that there's, I mean, very rarely do we get a denial. It's always, you know, with caution, or with, yeah.
Yes.
Like the one we got very recently.
So,
yeah.
Yes, the one you got
Article
recently,
8,
which
right.
was an awful lot of discussion of a pretty minor thing.
Yeah.
But, okay. Yes, and you should always take caution seriously because the Attorney General really does not like to disapprove bylaws if she can possibly avoid it. And so it'll be interesting to see what she does with these new ones. The ones that come from us will fly by, but I assume that some other people will skirt closer to the line, skate closer to the line. Than we're inclined to do.
So you said Hopkinton is rewriting? Is somebody in the queue ahead of us that's, say, several months ahead of us in the
yes,
process?
Yes, because, so. Are any of the other chance?
Wellesley's on hold. Wellesley's addressing it, just Hopkinton.
All right, so from our seven towns, two are going to Springtown meeting.
Okay.
So they will be in the queue ahead of you.
All right, that's good.
That,
so we can
that
see
means,
happens.
And I'm sure there are plenty of other towns that we don't represent that are also going to Springtown meeting with it.
Okay.
And so by the time November rolls around, we will have guidance from the Attorney General of some sort.
All right.
Right. I mean, from a practical point of view, you know, looking at what we have right now, just simply looking at our definitions, there are a few of them that basically fall off the plate, but not a whole lot. In other words, it's the categorization of signs in the definitions, which we may have to adjust, rather than some of the regulations further into the section.
The bylaw could be pretty broad at first, and we can slowly amend it as we go forward and understand it better.
Mm-hmm.
Are there any? Yeah, actually, go ahead, Jean.
I was just going to ask about. I've seen in some of the other bylaws, signed bylaws, that there's a little bit in the beginning, maybe even before the definitions, talking about the importance of. Pulling a sign permit, filing for a sign permit. So I know we have an administrative section that talks about permits and enforcement and that kind of thing, but when I was reading this one bylaw, and I can't remember which town it was from, it seemed like a very good reminder to applicants who are going through the process that they have to, it isn't just the regulation, but you also have to apply for an actual building permit to install a sign and to remove a sign. We get that, people get fouled up on that all the time. So I didn't know if it was a good place to put that or if it was confusing the matter because we have a section on administration, but I would just throw that out there that if there is an opportunity to clarify the process in the bylaw, it would be nice to have that.
Okay.
I mean, purely from a day-to-day operational kind of thing. Because even when people come before the CPDC for, like we just did those two certificates of appropriateness, we always put in the decision and we always remind them that they have to still apply for a sign permit, building permit, but sometimes they think they're done. And then they can miss that part.
And do you want to remain in the business of issuing certificates of appropriateness?
Yes.
For the districts and circumstances that have, if you will, design guidelines, yes. Business B is one of those. And probably the smart growth districts are also in there. It's not.
Okay. What kind of exposure, I guess risk exposure are we facing right now with our current bylaw?
Well, as long as the zoning enforcement officer refers to town council before he takes to enforce anything, then we're good. But generally speaking, I think we need to be very cautious about trying to enforce anything that's in the sign bylaw, but as it stands.
Except by mutual agreement, basically, with the
regulator,
with the applicant.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know, if they are willingly following what's written, then that's not a problem.
That's right. No, it's really more of a problem when you get into enforcement. So.
Yeah. What happens in historic districts? What happens on places like Nantucket, for example, or even older places like that? They must have very strict sign bylaws.
Well, that's an interesting question. So, what we have, the position we've taken here in Reading is that the Historic District Commission, for example, can impose guidelines on basically the way everything looks, the visual aspect of the structure of the property. And I would imagine that the way a sign looks, and all of those things could be regulated as under historic district, but again, not the content. So, you know, if you say all the freestanding signs on the historic property must be smaller than X, or must be located in a particular location, must be all of those kinds of things that a historic district commission might want to do, you know, do all of those things. Just can't regulate the content of those signs.
But they could regulate, like, colors, materials,
yes.
Things like that.
And a historic district commission can absolutely regulate the color and the content and all that stuff. Color and the materials, I'm sorry.
Right.
So I assume that's what much as I would like to be the town council of Nantucket, I don't know much about how they do it down there, but the entire town is a historic district, I know that. So everything needs to go before the historic district commission. Every spindle.
Yeah. Interesting to see what they do. If they do anything. it might be mutually agreed upon by anybody who really does business down there to conform to this particular appearance.
Well, again, it's it can certainly regulate what the sign looks like, just not what's what its content is. So if they want to say they all have to be under 2 feet and be held up with cast iron, filigree, whatever. Mm-hmm. They can do that.
Is there any ability to say, to give discretion to the historic district, for example? So if we said all signs on historic properties have to be 2x2 and held up by a cast iron post, unless determined by the historic district, or to give them the ability to vary from that?
Sure.
Without giving
we just them don't want the, we just don't want them to write a decision that says we're doing this because it's a no parking sign.
Right. Right. Well, they would write the decision the way they wanted to, the way they were supposed to. I'm just saying, we have a lot of those regulations. I think we just wrote something that has that. It's the communications.
Oh yeah,
the salt
towers.
References.
We just wrote. And we have
yes.
a list of preferences, and we say, well, we can bypass these if we want.
Mm-hmm.
That kind
yeah,
of language. We can have that kind of language in there.
And the AG cautioned us strongly on that. Particular one.
We didn't remove it, though.
No, I didn't.
I think you can do it. Again, you don't want to say you can waive it if it's, you know, a particular type of a sign.
No, it's more about the conditions of that property.
Mm-hmm.
Might lend itself to a sign being different than what we
yep.
Envisioned first.
Mm-hmm. You could do that.
Right.
Okay.
I don't think there's any problem with that.
Do we have any hints or hazard of the corporate architecture issue? The McDonald arches and the so forth, is that at all impacted by this change in approach? I mean, there's an there has long been tension between the, you know, I want to build my Chili's to look like every other Chili's on the planet.
Mm-hmm.
And the corporate architecture, is the decision silent on that issue, or is it extending that into the signage realm?
So the decision is more or less silent on that, but I mean, so the original McDonald's, the arches were built into the building. Is that what you were referring to as
yeah.
the corporate architecture?
Well, and its changes to that have been negotiated by a large number of the towns, and I mean certainly New England, like the
uh-huh.
Bedford. You know, whenever they put in a new McDonald's, they don't try and build the old style because the towns basically won't allow it.
Okay, and so. I won't allow it because I don't know why they won't allow it, but it could be too tall. It could be illuminated. These are all things that you can regulate. If it's part of the building, it's regulated just the same as any other feature of a building. It can't be too tall and it can't be too close to the side mm-hmm. yards and all that stuff. If it's a separate freestanding sign, you know, with the arches, you see those a lot as well. You can't say you can't put the arches there, but you can say it can't be more than this high and
okay.
can't be illuminated and, you know, all different kinds of things that you can say.
So it's no obvious immediate change in the status quo, which is
no,
good.
No, I think no obvious change.
Okay.
Just can't, while you're regulating it, you can't describe what you're regulating in terms of its content.
Right.
Anything else on this?
No.
I'm exhausted.
Those open signs are going to be a big problem. Those flags, almost every business.
I think we'll figure out a way.
Well, it's not that it's not that you can't allow flags that say open. It's just that you can't allow only flags that say open. If you want to say our sign bylaw doesn't apply to flags, now all flags are exempt, you're good.
No, we don't want to do that. Why can't, we could say a commercial property can have one flag.
You could say that.
Aside from state or U.S. flag.
Probably can't say that though, right? You can specify the U.S. flag.
Getting close to content.
Those are exempt.
Yeah, but you can't because there's no content.
Yeah, they're exempt now, but I'm concerned about, you know, you can say we have one set of rules for the Massachusetts and the U.S. flag.
Mm-hmm. But we do have, we would have control over those, you know, flexible arc things that overhang a sidewalk or in public space. So, I mean, if it's on their property, you know, we probably have less say about it.
For those. We could make a 20-foot setback when there's only 15 feet of space and it have to be on the building.
Those are the ones that like Stop and Shop plants in the tree
right.
lawn. And it's
a
big,
yeah.
big
like
lollipop.
Attention,
yeah.
Like attention's down.
Yeah.
We'll be in touch.
Yeah. Thank you.
So you want me to stay for the next discussion as well?
I guess that's up to the board.
Yeah. Well, the subcommittee timeline and next steps, that?
The timeline probably
yeah.
would be worth.
All right.
Yeah.
Timeline and next steps, yeah. That's the one I was thinking.
All right, so let's move to that. So in our last meeting, we pretty much came to agreement on what we think our zoning priorities are gonna be. We defined the leads of the subcommittees. And then I asked Julie to put together a draft of the timeline, the milestone timeline that we needed to, the milestones we needed to hit so we could be ready for November 14th. And that's what we have here. I don't know if you have a copy of this, but we'll make sure you get one. But ultimately, I mean, the first draft due March 28th for review on April 4th, second draft due May 2nd for review on May 9th, final draft due May 26th for review on June 6th, and then on June 20th we'd start our public hearings. That's quite a schedule.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you generally hold your public hearings on your regularly scheduled meeting dates?
Yes.
Okay, I wasn't sure, but.
Yeah.
I mean, unless it's.
Like a full agenda.
Right. Or if it's a topic that has a very large audience.
So Nick, for signs, what are your opinions on that timeline, considering what we just heard?
It's crazy, but we're gonna do something. Try something.
Well, I'm wondering if there's anything we can do, like a quick tactic or a quick adjustment we can make to our existing bylaw to buy us some time to mitigate some of that risk or exposure? Or do we need to go in full bore for November and rewrite this whole thing?
I don't want it. That'd be messy.
Yeah. I mean, I suspect that, I mean, we might have time to do a surgical elution, if you will, whatever the right word is.
I was just thinking, you know, if there was something minor we could do for November to buy us more time for April.
There is. We just don't enforce it.
Or yeah. Well,
okay.
Right now, everybody's reading.
You could do that, or you could, you know, do what what you did for medical marijuana and pass a moratorium. But
that says what? No signs? Nobody can put a sign up?
Or everybody can do it whatever you want. So, I mean, you know, you don't want to also publicly state that you're not going to enforce the zoning that invites people. I mean, that's the same thing as declaring a moratorium.
Well, I wouldn't be enforcing the potentially controversial parts of it. I still think there are valid parts to our zoning.
Mm-hmm. I agree. But, I don't know, March 28th is, you know, what, 3 weeks from now?
5 days.
Yeah.
Right.
But that's okay, because this first draft might be more going through this and going through the model bylaw that you've given us.
We go through our bylaw and just highlight all the things that we need to figure out how to reword or take out.
Yeah.
So here where it says March 28th and it says first draft, you don't mean an actual draft.
No, I'm thinking it's this table and the Hopkinton or whichever other model bylaw you're giving us and a lot of red. It sort of indicates the direction we're looking at. Hopkinton or the model.
I think you would rather use the model. I mean,
the model. Okay.
Understand, many other towns are much more blasé about signs than you are. So.
No, I wasn't sure if the model was actually Hopkinton's, but you're saying there's actually a general, this international.
This international one is, yeah.
Right.
I mean, Stockbridge used it, so you could, you know, maybe look at what's, you know, I'd be happy to share what Stockbridge did with it.
Yeah, we'll look at this and we'll look at what Stockbridge did. Yeah. We'll look at the table you put together and we'll start to figure out how much of it applies or how much of it's good. What might be missing from this that we want to bring over from the other? I think that's okay as a first draft.
Yeah, I can help with that.
Okay. And what role would you like me to play in that?
Right.
Review and answer questions that come up.
Okay. That's easy.
There may be more in the second and third and the final draft. More effort from you on the other drafts, but I think this first effort will push through what we think it is, and that'll also let us know whether we're understanding it correctly too.
Right.
Who's going to participate in this subcommittee with you?
I was waiting to hear from some of the public whether they were able to.
Mr. Chairman, I have checked. I can participate.
Excellent.
That's good.
That is good. Yes.
Anybody else that wants to? Anybody else that wants to come as well? We'll just figure out a time. Okay.
Okay. Good. Do we want or need town council at those discussions, or?
I think going off and having a working group and then bringing it back probably the best use of everybody's time.
Yeah. Need to grind out something first.
I think Marielle, did you say you want it? That's good.
Yeah, good. In the interest of the rest of your evening, I mean, do we need town council anymore for this discussion? I know we've got 40R site plan review minor amendments.
It probably is worth discussing a little bit the process if we were going to go with an amendment to 40R. Procedurally, it's a little bit different than some of the other zoning work that we do because of the state. And a little bit of guidance on that. I mean, I know we've talked about it just kind of generally. That DHCD has to be involved in any modifications.
When we talked about it before, you were thinking that you didn't necessarily want much in the way of substantive modification. Mostly you just wanted to expand the 40R district.
The boundaries.
So there's a map change. And then we have a general recommendation from before that we take all those definitions out of there and reconcile them with the definitions elsewhere. But other than that, you're not looking to make substantive changes, right?
Well, I don't know if that's true, because if we're expanding into certain districts, we're talking about having sub-districts. We'd need some additional controls for some of the sub-districts. So Green Street, for example, has a lot of smaller residential properties on it. We would want whatever is happening there to reflect that feel. Other side of Lincoln Street, you know, controlling where there could be commercial or not commercial. So that there's some additional language that you see in there.
Okay. And
we've also talked about...
I just don't know whether you have... Do you have a working relationship with a liaison person at DHCD?
Yes.
Or is that somebody that disappeared?
No, but the time that it takes to get any kind of response back is extremely challenging.
Yes.
One of the things we've talked about generally is the percentage of affordable housing under the 40R district. The way the zoning is written, it's a 20% requirement for affordable housing.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we have projects, for example, that are rental, we only get credit for those units that are affordable.
Yeah.
If we were to increase that percentage to 25%, we would get full credit for all the units in a rental development.
Right.
So that's something to think about as well.
Yes. Many, many towns are meeting their SHI quota, subsidized housing inventory quota, 10%. Because they are allowing rental apartment complexes to be developed as either LIPS or 40Bs or pursuant to 40R with 25% affordable.
Mm.
And they get credit for all of that. Only in Massachusetts would the subsidized housing inventory allow you to include a whole lot of housing that is not subsidized at all. But it's the rule, and that's how towns are dealing with it by allowing these rental units. But you've got to allow 25%. If you're already allowing 20%, it doesn't make sense to say, oh no, it can be 20%. That's all. You should be required.
Except that at Haven Street, we had a fight with a developer because they couldn't afford to even put in what they did put in. Didn't we subsidize part of that?
We did. We had to subsidize it out of the Affordable Housing Trust Fund. Sizable amount. So that's the difficulty, is you don't want to put a regulation in that chills development only to end up doing better on your subsidized housing inventory. You know, we don't want to sour the positive environment that we have.
Show us how to fix that.
I highly doubt a 5% increase is going to chill the housing market.
Right?
It's absolutely not going to stop it.
It's going to stop the developer from putting them in. That, it already did. You're wrong. It already did. At Haven Street, they wouldn't do it.
They
said their pro forma showed that they couldn't make it work at 25%.
They
couldn't
even
make
it work at
20%.
They couldn't.
We fought for that. We had to pay for part of that. So if you can figure out a way for us not to have to pay for the housing that we need.
We're just not really encountering that in other towns. So I'm surprised that's what the pro forma actually showed.
And we really drilled down into that pro forma.
How long ago was this?
Take it 4 years ago. Oh, we didn't just take the pro forma and go, oh, okay, well then.
No, I'm not suggesting you are.
We hired a special consultant to get all the information and drill down and look at it and evaluate it and.
Interesting.
Right. It was like pulling teeth at
20%. I'm just not seeing that in other towns. So I'm surprised.
Under 40R or under 40B?
Under 40B mostly.
Well, I think that's probably got more flexibility in it than 40R.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they go into 40B knowing that that's what they have to provide, and so they figure out a way to make financials work.
Right.
Yeah.
But the point is, if they can figure out a way to make the financials work, I'm surprised that they were not able to figure out a way to make the financials work in a 40R. Is there something unique about that property that would make it difficult, more expensive?
Well, it was
underground parking,
yeah.
Right there.
Yes. Underground parking and the municipal lot behind, which they paid for the reconstruction of.
But the underground parking is like off the charts expensive.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll go with that.
30,000 space.
I was going to say, you don't see underground parking requirements.
Can we add a 25% incentive?
Well, that's what we're saying. Yeah, into some kind of an offset.
Mm-hmm.
There's going to be a unit increase because then that throws the whole balance off.
Well, no, they have to give it all.
No, but you've got, but it still has to be 25%, so you can't say.
Yeah, 25%.
You know what I mean? They have to provide 25%. They can add more units.
But as long as they still maintain that 25%.
Yeah.
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 Right. Maybe it's the parking.
We have to figure out what that was.
Yeah.
Well, but presumably you didn't require underground parking lightly, right?
They had half dug a basement because the building already had an underground section. And they worked with that.
So it wasn't required. It was just something that they chose to do?
They couldn't get the parking there if they didn't do that anyway. The whole building was on the site. So.
Okay. Well.
We could go back down to 1.0 for parking.
Mm-hmm. See how it works.
No. Not necessarily.
On the heels of.
Okay. So my initial presumption is really not correct. There are a fair number of substantive changes
yeah.
that are going to be needed as well. So,
however, that is a good point, right? If we could find expanded boundaries that work with the bylaw the way it's written, then perhaps this first move is to expand in those areas or expand that boundary.
Mm-hmm.
Talked about across Main Street, right?
Right.
If the bylaw as written works with just a simple expanded boundary in a certain section, then maybe we just do that quickly.
Yeah.
And
we're
on the other stuff.
The other thought I had was basically expand it by adding sub-districts. Basically identify the expansions as a sub-district without initially distinguishing the requirements. But, basically give us a framework to change them when we know what we want to do.
So identify it as a separate sub-district, but for now not have any special rules applying in the sub-district. With the idea that special rules will come later.
Would those be in the regulations, the CPDC's regulations? Oh, would it have to be in the zoning?
No, I think it would have to still be the zoning. But you just...
Or, design guidelines, too, is what...
Yeah, but so if we put in place a sub-district, can somebody... Is the assumption that the rest of the bylaw applies to that sub-district until there are rules for the sub-district?
Well, you'd have to say
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
But, yes. I mean,
but
yes.
We don't want the rules in the sub-district. That's the point. So
you'll take a quick look and see if it's harmful.
I'm not sure
or
it'll
if
pass
it's
that, right?
It won't pass, especially. Mm-hmm. So that's why I was saying there are certain areas, I think, where the bylaw can work the way it's written. We could focus on just expanding there while we work on sub-district.
Mark that out. Yeah.
Complexity of sub-district,
mm-hmm.
complexity of the
20% versus 25%.
Right. Gene is right. The wild card here is getting DHCD to conduct its review in a timely fashion. I was trying to see So if you, so for example, if you, if you give it to them, if you go through this process and you come to a final draft on May 26th, you try to give it to them then, you're not, you can't be sure that you'll have comments back in time for July 11th hearing. Do you think you would? I don't think you would.
The last document we needed them to review was at Johnson Woods, and it took a year.
All right. Well, that's not reasonable. But
that's what it took.
Okay. So I think what you want to do with for your substantive changes is you want to make little discrete substantive changes that are easy.
Yeah. Do
I changing 20% to 25%. You might be able to get that reviewed quickly. But if you want to do a sort of overhaul, you want to start on this schedule and then just see how fast you can get DHCD to cooperate with you. And with the idea that, well, if it's not ready for November, it's ready for whenever it's ready.
Yeah.
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 That's true.
So can you kind of grease the skids with that? Say, hey, we're working on it?
No, we got to get some work done first.
I can email the guy that I've been working with for 6.5 years, and he's going to email back, oh, sure, send me what you got. And
by the way, I'm on vacation.
Exactly.
Wow.
July and August, right?
Well, yeah.
So, Dave, you're heading up that subcommittee.
Like you?
Yeah.
Sort of support or involvement would you like?
Oh, I don't know yet.
A member of the Board of Selectmen was eager to be involved in doing that.
I think we started, and I think we just keep moving until we hit that roadblock, and if it stops us from going to this first town meeting, we should have the next one.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah.
Okay.
I can't believe, though, that we can't get something out of them faster than a year.
Well, that was the last one.
Yeah.
Somebody was out on a leave of some kind, so that followed it up. And I think it was a lip. So it was the different part of DHCD.
Okay.
It was a regulatory agreement that we needed them to review for lip.
Okay. All right.
It seems pretty standard, but it wasn't.
All right.
Isn't George also helping you with that, too? Didn't he agree?
George Kasoufis?
Yeah.
I think so.
Mm.
I'm going to have to start keeping a notebook.
Okay. And then we have site plan review, which John has taken on. I don't know if we had anybody slotted to help him yet.
I've written a draft.
On people that may want to, that may be good candidates to work with John on that. Why don't we submit them to Julie? And then minor amendments, which I have, I'll take a look at those, and maybe Julie, you and I can talk, and Gene, and figure out if there's some people that we want to interview that may have kind of brought these minor items up.
Dave's home services.
Oh,
Dave
yeah.
He
indicated that he wants to be informed and would love to tell you why it's an issue for him.
Okay.
Yeah, he parks at the site that's Doucette Movement.
Yeah.
Reading Village. Reading Village site. and he has, once that site is redeveloped, he has no place to park his vehicles.
What's behind Global Petroleum?
On Washington Street?
Yeah. Looks like they cleared a lot.
They did, and they, and we sent multiple violation notices to them. Parking, it's got approved for, I think, a two-family. And the property owner is difficult. Mark Scarson?
Trucks.
Trucks, yes.
Yep. We've also got, what is it, the oil company on Main Street?
Smith Oil.
I mean, I don't know.
Yep.
That's the other.
That's not the one that was on the hit list. They have removed some of those Quonset huts or whatever they're called.
Quonset huts, yeah.
They moved a couple of
them. Can't regulate
Quonset huts is where you have a celebration every year, December.
With all your storage.
So I know they've taken some steps, but it's still a pretty messy site.
All right, and Karen, we have you slotted as working with Jean and Julie for outreach coordination. I mean, did we have an idea of what that role entailed, what we were thinking when we...
Wasn't this to make sure that we were including the business community on some of these topics and town meeting members were aware, just that whole community outreach?
Well, I think working with them on how we want to...
And John was talking about
updates.
Some sort of electronic
like
method
other
of
ways of reaching people.
Yeah.
So maybe
surveys
the three of you can get together at some point to figure out how we want to keep folks informed of the progress of these, because it was a pretty strong commitment we made when we did that priority workshop.
Yeah.
Does that sound all right?
But also of collecting that information, so polls, some sort of online polling or some sort of online engagement.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, are we considering this timeline, like these milestones? Is this what we're going to use? Granted, we can kind of define what we consider a first draft and a second draft, and that's totally fair. But is this what we want to work towards? It seems as good a draft as any.
And at a certain point, if we're not there, we just say we're not there yet.
Yeah.
If we're not there, we're not there.
Being aspirational.
Yes.
Yes. Very much so. All right. Well, thanks for putting this together.
Sure.
It's helpful.
Thanks for asking.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks.
Thank you.
So when is our next meeting?
21st.
Okay. So do we want to have an agenda topic to just talk about any progress that's been made?
Yeah,
any roadblocks?
I don't know anything in the queue so far.
We don't have anything on the agenda as of right now, so I mean, it could be a big night of discussion of...
Yeah. As much as I... What am I, canceling a meeting? It's time that... maybe well spent discussing these topics.
Because you don't have that many meetings in April because of town meeting.
Oh, yeah.
So
yeah, we've got,
yeah.
What is it, March 17th is the next go-round with the Reading Village.
Yep.
Yes.
ZBA.
Do you anticipate attending?
Yes.
Yeah.
Maybe. Put it out to committee.
Yeah. Yeah, so you're only scheduled to meet once in April, on April 4th.
Oh, wow. And when's town meeting?
Town meeting is the 25th.
And we'll want to, and I'll want to provide an update on the work that we're
yes.
doing. And stay far, far away from the 40B in that discussion.
Yeah. That bypasses zoning, so
it does.
So.
In your dreams.
Yeah, right.
Well, as a board, there's no role.
We have no authority, understand.
Yeah.
So we've got two more quick things, hopefully quick, because I'm sure we're going to get out of here. We got minutes and then the debrief on the meeting with the Board of Selectmen. Let's talk about that first.
So the minutes actually kind of, the minutes that I sent you today are kind of the summary of that.
Yeah.
I just printed the pages that are relevant to you, if anyone knows what I edited.
Oh, but these are the Board of Selectmen meeting minutes, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're not, yeah.
Okay.
Is, you know, is there, because it was a joint meeting, is there an expectation or requirement that we have board minutes of our own? Since the board.
What I usually do when I do minutes for joint meetings, they'll have the same set of minutes, but I'll just make a copy with the heading that says Board of Selectmen minutes, and then the other set of minutes will say CPDC.
Okay.
But they will essentially be the same, minutes.
Once.
Mm-hmm.
So if we have edits or comments to this, does the Board of Selectmen have to approve those?
I suppose the Board of Selectmen's meeting tomorrow. So I suppose I could do your changes tonight and put them in the Board of Selectmen minutes tomorrow, so when they approve them, your additions will already be in there, so they'll approve them as well.
Okay.
So it's all the same set that gets.
So, yeah, let's do
that.
Let's go through the meeting minutes.
Okay.
Let's go through the meeting minutes from that portion of the discussion. And we can ask questions. And I mean, I've just got a few questions on, there were a lot of requests made for more information in that meeting, and I'd like to understand if anything has happened in response to that.
More information from the applicant?
No, more information from us and from the town, you know, citizens. I think Mrs. Blodgett had a very good recommendation of, I want to see what it's going to look like from Haven Street across the tracks. Do we have any idea, have we?
Well, that's a request from the applicant, and that request was actually made in early February at the zoning board meeting as well.
By the ZBA?
Yes,
for that?
And
okay.
So that's on their list. I sent them a memo with things that we've asked for, and that is on the list. And I emailed today to ask for an update on whether we'd be getting new information for the ZBA meeting next week, and they said they're working on it.
Okay.
So it was a little bit of a vague response, but I think there might be some new information coming before next Thursday.
Okay.
They want to make progress. I mean, otherwise it just gets dragged out longer, so.
Yeah. But there's kind of a statute of limitations, right? I mean, 180 days, and if things aren't, is that, did
it's
I understand that correctly?
The board has 180 days from opening the hearing to render a decision unless continuances are granted by the applicant.
And if,
but like progress needs to be made. I mean, it's not gonna default to an approval if they're not responding to any.
Will it not really?
I don't think so. No, I mean, I can't speak as an attorney on that, and our attorney's not here. But if they're not making any like progress towards responding to anything that's requested of them, I don't think that takes away our legal standing.
Okay.
The way I understood it was one of the best things we could do is actually deny some of the relief they're asking for. Because at that point, they then have to prove that that makes the project financially unfeasible.
Right.
So if we said you can't have 77 units or you can't have this height, you can't have this setback, and we start shrinking all of this, they would have to come back and say, we can't make it work because we need 70 units and this is why. They'd have to finally show
well,
their hand.
Yeah, demonstrate that.
Okay, that's good.
But then denying a waiver, really, the grounds to deny a waiver rests on whether granting the waiver would be a significant impact, negative impact to the public health, safety, and welfare, such that that would trump the need for affordable housing. So the board has to kind of walk that fine line.
Mm-hmm. So they have to have stable grounds to make those, or I guess they'll deny certain aspects of the project. Okay.
But hopefully that's where the peer reviewers come in and say, you know, here's the rationale for what works, what doesn't with this project. And that's hopefully where you hang your hat.
Okay. Have they started work?
Oh, yeah.
They're doing 25% affordable, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, you could make an argument that if you knocked off 10 units, you're only taking away 3 affordable units, 2
mm-hmm.
and a half. And that that is not endangering or affordable housing in the state.
Right.
2 units for the health side, health and welfare of that neighborhood.
It would actually be 10 units, though.
That's the fake number that we were just talking
about.
Yeah,
I know, but that's unfortunately, that's the number that we have.
Well, we're not
going to
solve all of the affordable housing problems in this one project.
Right.
And so to destroy the neighborhood with this additional height and the potential for fire risk. And
no, I agree. I just wanted to clarify.
Yeah.
It's 10.
Okay. Well, we could probably argue it the other way. It's actually only 2.5. It counts towards 10, but they're not renting 10 units at affordable rates.
No, I don't work for the state.
Right.
Don't argue with me.
They're only renting 2 of those units at that rate.
Right, no, I get it. I think it's the worst loophole I've ever seen.
Yeah.
In terms of affordable housing.
Mm-hmm.
So potentially you could make that argument.
Okay.
I think you could. At least enough to get them to come back with something.
Okay. So let's just crank through these minutes real quick, at least for the Board of Selectmen meeting.
I did have one comment on page 4. The third paragraph down, it says where it talks about what I was asking them. The last sentence says, he asked what the fire rating is between the garage and the building.
Mm-hmm.
He misunderstood me when I first asked that, and then he tried to explain it. Why I was asking him that was because they're stating that the building height, their building height starts on top of the garage, not at ground.
Right.
And I was asking him what section of the code allows him to do that. He never really answered that. So I would like you to add to the end of that sentence, where it's in the building, that allows the building code determined height to start at the top of the podium.
Do you want to say what section of the code as well?
Yeah, he asked which section of the code. Actually, the fire rating part isn't really relevant.
Right. Allows the building height to be
measured
from the top of the podium.
Yeah, any way you want to write it. But
okay.
That was the intent on my question, because they're getting an extra 15 feet. By the way, when they said that they do meet all of the building limits of the building code, they're actually maxing it out. They're taking every exemption and every allowance they can, you know, by having sprinklers that allows them to get extra height, and some of the street front allows them to get a little extra height. So while they're within limits of the code, they're really pushing the limits of the code.
Right, right.
Page 5, the fourth paragraph from the bottom, Mr. Jones.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's supposed to be Reading, the second sentence. Reading is not, is he saying quite a commuter town or a quiet commuter town?
No, I think he was agreeing with
okay.
the statement above that was that John Weston made about how it's only partly transit oriented because we're not like.
Right.
So we don't approve these, right? Oh, we do?
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry. I missed that. Okay. I'm good.
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes of the joint Board of Selectmen and CPDC meeting of February 23rd, 2016, as amended.
Second.
All those in favor? Abstain?
Right.
Any other comments or questions we want to discuss or ask on 40B, 40R conversation that we had? No? All right, let's move to the February 22nd meeting minutes, which is from the zoning workshop.
I only have one comment on that. On page 4, it was the vote, the CPDC meeting minutes vote. Since Mr. Hansen abstained, it should be 301.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Out of curiosity, at one of the town meetings, one of the town meeting members brought up the statement and that the voting report normally does not include abstentions.
That's Mr. Brown, right?
Yeah. I mean, this is something that I don't know, but it's something that clicks back into my brain whenever I see the 400 or the...
Is it something like it doesn't allow for abstentions?
What
the
doesn't?
The rules don't allow for abstentions for board.
Recording abstentions, yeah.
But I don't think that's a good idea. Mm.
I don't know, we'll have to take a look at that.
Is that like an open meeting law rule or a Roberts rule?
I don't know.
Yeah.
I didn't look into it. I remember him saying it.
Right. Homework. Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of February 22nd, 2016, as amended.
Second.
All those in favor? And abstain? All right. Any general planning updates?
You know, it's been all about this 40B. We've been so busy with that. I can't think of anything else substantive. I mean, there's a lot of little stuff going on. We're spending a little bit of time with the building inspector trying to get more work done on the code enforcement, not signs, but code enforcement, like we were talking about, you know, these pesky violations that are out there. But the permitting is certainly busy. I mean, in 2015, they issued 1,000 building permits.
Wow.
That's just like off
wow.
the charts. It's almost double what it was the year before. 400 more than the previous year. It's a tremendous volume of permitting. And now that we have the electronic permitting software, you know, we think we're pushing the permits out a lot faster. We have a very excellent administrative assistant who does a great job of tracking everything and following up and making sure the contractor's license is on file and whatnot. And she's actually able to issue some of the permits. The building inspector has said to her, you know, doors and windows and whatever. She can issue them. So would even doing same-day permits. You come into the counter to apply for a permit to change out some windows, get it right then and there. So I think we're working a lot smarter, certainly a lot of volume, and even on the site visits, it's just they're doing 10, 12, 13 site visits a day, the building inspectors, so. So it's busy, but it's good. And as I said, the software really helps to link with historical and conservation and all that, so we're making sure we get that right too. But as far as any big projects, I think Professor's Market is now open. It is.
I went in the other day.
Okay.
Really?
Where's
that?
That's the old
Quiznos.
Oh, okay.
Did you notice any lettering on the windows?
No, he asked me about it.
Okay, because he asked me about it over email,
yeah.
So I need to respond. But I didn't know if it was one of those, like, put it up and beg for forgiveness.
No, when did he ask?
Just a couple days ago. Mm.
Yeah, I went in there on Saturday with my son, and he asked me, he goes, what do I have to do about that? I'm like, you don't have to call
email Julie.
Julie or Jean. You don't have to come before us again.
Yeah, he and I traded some calls on Thursday, I think.
Okay.
So now, just a point of interest, I mean, the bridal shop is still in the demo delay?
Yes.
Okay.
Historical has asked for some, I guess there's a beehive oven in there and some other things that they want to, whether they want some sort of photograph or something to, you know,
okay.
kind of nail that down, that those last few pieces. So that's what they're working through.
And the Once Upon a Time Getty Station, I noticed has been cleared and has a new sign.
Yeah, I don't know.
Any idea there? Okay.
No. And
where
Perfectos is,
that?
Is day by day.
I'm cladding it.
Well,
yeah.
One piece of
Perfectos, I mean, I heard the tale from their across the street neighbor about the traffic accident.
Oh, that was.
A while
a year
back.
Ago, I think.
They continued to cross there, though, one at a time.
Oh, yeah.
I was trying to get through, and they just run across the road to get their coffee.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
What about?
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
I have a couple updates I could provide.
Yeah, go ahead.
So our community compact application to the state was approved, so now we just have to have a big event where it gets signed. And then work with the state to figure out how to implement some of the best practices that we've selected. Our complete streets policy received an 88 out of 100, which is actually pretty good according to their scoring system, and puts us into the next tier, which we put together a prioritization plan for where we want to have complete streets infrastructure in town, and then seek, they have $400,000 of funding available for the
cool.
next, I think, 2 years. So we're working on that. And then we're also about to kick off our hazard mitigation planning effort, the second go around. Jesse started it and then left, and so we're picking it back up with the funding that was approved at town meeting in November. So we've hired MAPC to help us with the effort, so.
And which, this is what, road hazard or?
It's like all the hat flooding.
It's
and
like disaster recovery.
Yeah.
Kind of
stuff. Yeah, mostly flooding probably in this area, but they'll touch on other ones.
Okay.
So we're going to have a session with MEMA at the end of the month to sort of understand the MEMA process and what they look at and what we need to do to have our plan be certified. And
if you need any help on that, I work in business continuity, so I can just help out if you need brain power, bodies, whatever.
Great. It's good to know.
Yeah. How to turn the town wells back on. If we ever need it.
And you probably saw the budget that went around. So the Board of Selectmen added in a position for economic development in our department. So we'll see if town meeting agrees with that. That would be funded entirely out of the Permits Revolving Fund. So it wouldn't come out of the actual budget. It's offset by that funding source.
Yeah.
So.
Does the permit fund actually cover permitting costs?
The Permits Revolving Fund is sort of a separate dedicated fund that the bigger projects, Redding Woods, Oak Tree, All those permitting fees went into that fund.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's at about 750,000 right now. So this will give us an opportunity to spend down. And maybe I think they wanted to make like a 3-year commitment of 125,000 a year. We might not, we probably won't need all that, but.
Mm.
Yeah.
Everything good with the library? I saw.
Yeah.
There's gonna be a presentation at the Board of Selectmen tomorrow.
Yep. It's moving right along. Yeah, I haven't been in it, but I've heard it's really come along nicely.
Anything further on Walgreens?
We keep hearing, well, we got an email that they want to put in a paper store. I mean, a dollar store. I wish
paper
it was a paper
you.
Store.
I guess
a dollar store.
Dollars
no,
or paper.
Paper
yeah.
I haven't heard anything in a while, though. I mean.
Yeah, I kind of made that one inquiry that we didn't hear.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. It could be on the next agenda, though, because those
yeah.
signs that can come in at the last minute.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see.
Yeah.
Anything else?
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? All right. Thanks, folks.